Okay, let me frame my presentation here. It's a little bit maybe controversial. So I know the people up here can tell I look like I'm 39 years old, but actually I have more years behind me than in front of me in higher ed. And I decided a few years ago that maybe I need to start speaking my mind. And so I'm Breaking Bad, all right? So think of me as Walt. I might shave my head the next time I do a presentation, but I'm gonna drill right down to what I think is at the core of the problems that we have in engineering education. And of course, I see engineering education as a continuum, and we are part of engineering education, all right? So let me start off by saying that. So let me give you some historical context. Some of you know about this, some of you know much better than I do, but when you look at the Grinter Report of the ASEE in 1955, what most people really, if you don't drill down far enough, find out is that the committee that set it up actually had two recommendations. One is that engineering education needed to become more theoretical and scientifically based. But the other recommendation is that the engineering education that we're currently doing at that time was good, and they should be called applied engineers. That part of the report was rejected by the faculty in this nation. And that set us down the path that I call the fatal flaw in engineering education in the United States. So we basically abandoned practical engineering. Of course, engineering technology programs then started, Purdue being one of them, with our College of Technology being formed in 1964, but we historically were making these moves long before that. But our college, for example, started with only AS degrees, which again feeds into some of the misperceptions that we have around the nation yet. Another thing that's very important that sets the historical context in a different way actually relates to research. And Vannevar Bush, who was in the Roosevelt White House, was asked just before FDR passed away near the end of the World War II to create a report on how to sustain the kinds of research that were going on to support the war movement. And what he did, though, is he basically, to summarize things, said the only kind of research that's any good is theoretical research, and everything else doesn't apply. And in fact, all good technology evolves from theoretically based research. And anyone who's done any work in this knows that that's ridiculous. In fact, you can find a report that was done by the Department of Defense that was looking at some new technologies for aircraft. This report's about 10 years old, and they figured out about 99.7% of the technology that went into that new aircraft was actually existing technologies that were modified, and only 0.03% or 0.3% or whatever it was actually new knowledge. And so this set us off on this track that basically said if you don't do theoretical research in higher ed, it's kind of useless, and that's really not what we were set up for, when in fact it's a wrong premise. And that premise is refuted, and I highly recommend that you take a look at this book. It's called Pasteur's Quadrant. It's only about 120 pages long, and it has lots of pictures if that's helpful. But one of the pictures that are in there is this one, although I added actually faces. The book doesn't have this, but it's called Pasteur's Quadrant. And it basically says that research actually is quantified as, is there a consideration of use on this axis, and is there a quest for fundamental understanding on this axis? If it's low, or if it's high, and then if it's low, and if it's high. Well, this is what everyone thinks research is, which is pure basic research, and think of Niels Bohr or Einstein. There's probably not a lot of practical application for it. It's very important, not saying it's not important. We need to do a lot of that kind of research because at some point it does lead to other kinds of innovation. But the fact is there's actually quite a bit of research and evidence that a lot of good stuff happens here, one of which is called use-inspired basic research, and why it's called Pasteur's Quadrant. If you think of historically what Louis Pasteur had done with his career, he actually created a whole discipline of microbiology when there wasn't one based on his research. So this idea that you need new knowledge to advance research is ridiculous. He simply went about solving human problems at the time, solved the problems without really knowing why. The result of it came about in the form of microbiology, and a new discipline was created out of the ether. So the idea that you need to have fundamental research preceding all new knowledge is not true. And in fact, you can take it one step further, which is even closer to the kinds of research that we find important as applied engineers, thank you, Bruce, is that we have something here that's called Edison's quadrant, which is, if you think of Thomas Edison, and the easiest thing to think about is the light bulb, and you know all the story about him going through 1,000 or 2,000 different materials to try and find the one that would work in the light bulb, and he finally discovered it. He actually wrote a paper, which is a good reason why we still need scholarship, to physics professors picked up on that paper, went through it, discovered why it worked, came up with the electron theory, and ended up with the Nobel Prize in physics. Okay? So that is, again, one of the prejudices that we're working against in this nation. And in fact, the type of research that we can do in applied engineering or in engineering technology has great, great value. It's just hard for people to understand that because it's never presented in that way. And in deference to DIT, who does great works, we also studied the German model of higher education a few months ago, or about a year or so ago. We took some faculty over, some of which are in the audience here, from Purdue, and we found out that around 1970, Germany was still coming out of World War II and rebuilding their, you know, their country to a certain extent, and they created like two kinds of universities, if you will. Technical universities, which is where their scientifically prepared engineering programs are, and then universities of applied science, where they actually, and they call them applied engineers in that nation. They require internships, they require year-long senior-based industry-sponsored projects. There's all kinds of neat things that we can learn from what they've done there. But this is what is remarkable, and Michael Dierenfurth has actually helped me with this. It's hard to find exact statistics, but we've found evidence that Germany graduates twice as many applied engineers as theoretical engineers. In fact, we found some evidence it's actually three times as many. Now, if you look at the last ASEE publication that did a survey of graduates of engineering and engineering technology programs from ASEE, take a look at it. You will find that we graduate probably three or four times more theoretical engineers than we do Bachelor of Science applied engineers or engineering technologists. We've completely reversed the order entirely, in my opinion, because of the historical context that we're working in. And the idea that engineering technology is in fact an engineer is not recognized very well in this nation. And it's hurting us. If you look at Germany and how competitive they are in the world economy, I believe it's because of this statistic right there. That's what we need to start talking about more. We simply need more applied engineers in this nation. So let's look at the American model. By the way, I am not by any means criticizing the scientifically prepared engineering programs in this nation. We do it as good or better than anyone in the world. Keep on doing what you're doing. Keep on doing it better. But this is one of the problems we have, is many of the engineering technology programs are tied to tier two universities, and you know how it is, U.S. News and World Report rankings and all this other stuff. If you look at the Carnegie classification of the very high research universities, you can go on the website and do it right today. It's 108 of them. These are the only universities that I could find that had any kind of significant engineering technology programs. ASU has theirs on a different campus. A&M has the programs within their College of Engineering. University of Cincinnati has them in the College of Engineering. And if you go to their website, you'll see they're not accepting students in some of their programs, which probably means they're closing some of them, if not all of them. And the University of Houston has a College of Technology that stands alone. That's it. Okay? And so it's obviously that we aren't recognized at the rate that we, I think we should in this nation, because it seems to be that tier two is where we do this stuff, and that's just flat out wrong. So let me talk a little bit about, I mentioned this continuum before, and apologize, it's a little bit hard to read here, but if you think of a continuum of engineering higher education, you have what at the very, very far left applied and at the very far right theoretical. Well, this is kind of like your technical career education, which could be certificates or even AS or AAS degrees, right? And so it starts moving in this direction, you know, more coursework, more theory, until you get to this thing called the sweet spot, which I'll come back to. But this is kind of what everyone knows engineering is in this nation. It's science-based, you have BS, MS, and PhD degrees. I believe that this nation needs to develop this sweet spot, which I call applied engineers, which is basically our engineering technology, and we need both bachelor's, master's, and PhD degrees in all of them as we move forward. But that is the sweet spot, that's the blue ocean for this nation if we do it right. It's the blue ocean for us if we do it right. The same thing can be said in computer science. So you have the technical career education, you have the AS degree programs, and then you have, you know, computer science on this side, but then there's something called applied computing, or applied computer science is what they call it in German, all right? We need to develop that sweet spot because that is the blue ocean for all of us too. So the idea of engineering technology expanding into the computing disciplines is something that I think that has high value in the future of this nation. And then the accreditation flaw, okay? I haven't made enough enemies already. Let's talk about ABET now, all right? Here's the flaw that I see it. So we have EAC for the theoretically based engineering programs. We have ETAC, which is for us, the engineering technology. But I tell you what, at our university, when I explain that, and we have a state community college system called Ivy Tech, okay? Those are two-year programs. So in our state, everyone knows what Ivy Tech is and what it isn't. And at a research-intensive university like Purdue, when I tell them this thing right here, they look at me like I just stepped off a different planet. It's like, you're serious that you have the same accreditation as Ivy Tech? How do you find value in that? Okay? And that it's a problem because of that perception that's been hanging around this nation historically that I explained earlier. I'm not saying that two-year programs shouldn't be accredited, that there's anything wrong with two-year programs, but if it's holding us back, we need to seriously think about whether we either need to modify this one or have a third one that applies directly to BS engineering technology programs, so we can start that separation that we need to further define our discipline and to show people that in fact it's a continuum of engineering education, and we would then have more control about how we define ourselves instead of having other people define us, which is what's happening all the time. So what do we need to do? I think we need to create an applied engineering ABET accreditation. We need the NAE to create some type of report because they have great credibility and talk about some of the stuff in historical context and how we got to where we are right now, comparing it with other countries, increase the number of applied engineering programs. We need a different type of engineering education that serves the needs of industry. So this would be much more outward facing as far as what we do. And we need to place a higher value on career and technical education and secondary education. That's part of the STEM pipeline issue that we've gone away from, and we have to do something about our K through 12 system to bring some of these more interested students in the STEM disciplines, in particular engineering. You've seen some of this already. I leaned over after Mike was done because he basically set these slides up for me. This, by the way, is where we can really make a difference in our curricula and to get attention nationally. If we start focusing some of our efforts on what I call the higher order learning, that is not technology, we would be able to do something amazing with our programs that would bring great recognition, uniqueness, and distinction to it. So this isn't just about saying, okay, give us our due, we're applied engineers, change some things, but what if we actually talked about changing the undergraduate learning experience at the same time to prepare engineers for the 21st century and not the 19th, which is basically what is being done right now. And if you read what today's college students are like, I urge you to read the book called Generation on a Tightrope. It did a survey of 20 universities, one of which was Purdue, of undergraduate students from community colleges through research universities, found out what students are really like, you'd be shocked, what they're really thinking, what motivates them. And then the last chapter, I think it's chapter 8 on conclusions, read that chapter if you want to reform your curricula. Okay, because it'll tell you exactly how to do it, and it does all of this stuff right here. It prepares people to do that. Another great book is called The Global Achievement Gap by Tony Wagner, and he did a follow-on book on innovation. I can't remember the exact title. So what I'm suggesting is we create something called a Renaissance Applied Engineer by taking a rigorous engineering fundamental education that's applied. Business and entrepreneurship, remember, business acumen was important. Integration with the humanities, hands-on interdisciplinary approach, experiences that reflect actual engineering practices. I realize a lot of you already do this. We need to articulate this better and improve some of those things. And then as far as the student learning experience, of course, our strength is blending theory with practice. Integrate innovation, entrepreneurship, and commercialization experiences. Leadership, creativity. You can actually teach creativity that was pounded out of our students in K through 12 in most cases. Addition of business and enterprise practices. You'd be surprised how many graduates these days don't realize that public companies need to make money to stay in business. Addition of a year-long industry-sponsored design projects, required internships. You can go right down the list of what I think we need in order to really transform that learning experience. And we do this by the creation of what I call charter-like programs, by taking some risk, and we're doing this right now, and it has the attention of the Board of Trustees and the president of our university. In fact, our president's going to be here in Washington on Sunday to speak to the National Academy of Engineering. He's going to talk about this applied engineer and the Polytech Institute initiative that we have going on. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. I can talk to anyone about this a little bit later, but we're getting funded through the university to do this. It's basically going to be an incubator or a charter-like, so we call it an incubator though, that will create the face of technology education, engineering technology, whatever word you want to use, and it's going to create a 21st century education with some of these topics that you see there. We also talk about application-oriented research through what we call consumer-based or consumer-oriented research centers. Again, outward-facing and making innovation part of the whole learning experience. And so that's basically my senile attempt and my age to acting like an old grandpa who just goes around and says whatever they feel like, okay? And that's my view, in my opinion, of what we really do need to do to move this discipline forward, but more importantly, to help this nation. And that's a compelling story, and that's why it's getting so much attention on our campus. Because it's about making jobs, it's about being competitive, it's about being global, outward facing. It's about preparing students for the 21st century. And that's a very compelling story when you frame it in that manner. So thank you very much.